Myself, Professor Shahana Sengupta. I would like to welcome you all in my YouTube channel. Presently, I am associated with Swami Vivekananda Institute of Modern Science as an assistant professor in the Department of Microbiology. In my YouTube channel, usually I share different types of academic videos related to the different fields of biological science. Today, I have chosen a very trendy topic for all of you. Yes, my dear friends, you are right. Today, I will talk on vaccination. Let's start with our new journey with the new topic. Happy listening. Welcome to the world of vaccine. A vaccine is an immunobiological substance designed to produce specific protection against a particular given disease. A vaccine is antigenic in nature but not pathogenic. That means these substances are capable of stimulating an immune response, specifically activating lymphocytes, which are the body's infection-fighting white blood cells, without causing any harm to the host body. They are administered in the body of the host through a process called immunization. Broadly, we can categorize vaccine into two types, like prophylactic vaccines and therapeutic vaccines. Prophylactic vaccines are designed to build immunity in a patient. A prophylactic or preventive vaccine involves introducing antigens into a person's body. The goal is that individual's immune system will create antibodies for those antigens and become immune to the associated illness. Whereas a therapeutic vaccine is a kind of vaccine which is administered after the disease or infection has already occurred. The therapeutic vaccines works by activating immune system of the particular patient to fight towards the action produced by the specific antigen or the causative agent. Let's talk about the immunization. Immunization is the process of elicitating a long-lived state of protection against a disease-causing pathogen. Exposure to the live pathogen followed by recovery is one of the major route of immunization. Immunization can be done in two ways. One is known as passive manner of immunization, and second one is known as active manner of immunization. In passive immunization, the preformed antibodies are transferred to a recipient occurs naturally when there occur the transfer of maternal IgG across the placenta to the body of the developing fetus. Passive immunization can also be achieved by injecting a recipient with preformed antibodies called antiserum from immune individuals. Active immunization can be achieved by natural infection with the microorganisms or any causative agent or the antigens, or else it can be acquired artificially by means of administration of a vaccine. In active immunization, the immune system really playing an active role by proliferation of antigen-reactive T lymphocytes and B lymphocytes that ultimately induced in the formation of protective memory cells. Let me tell you about the popular story that lied behind the discovery of vaccination. Edward Jenner, who was an English doctor, the pioneer of smallpox vaccination and also can be called as father of immunology. In 1796, Jenner carried out his world famous experiment on an 8-year-old boy, James Phipps. Jenner inserted pus taken from a cowpox pustule and then inserted it into an incision on the boy's arm. Basically, he was testing his theory drawn from the folklore of the countryside that the milkmaids, who regularly get in contact with the cow, suffered from mild disease of cowpox, never ever contracted with the smallpox. Basically, during that period, smallpox was the greatest killer, particularly among the children. Jenner subsequently proved that, having been inoculated with cowpox, Phipps was immune to smallpox. He submitted a paper to the Royal Society in 1797, describing about his experiment. But he was told that his ideas were too revolutionary, that he need more proof. Undoubtedly, Jenner experimented on several other children, including his own 11-month-old son. The journey was not easy. In 1798, the results were finally published, and Jenner coined the word vaccine from the Latin word vacca for the cows. The second generation vaccines were introduced in late 1880s by another scientist, Louis Pasteur, who developed vaccine for chicken cholera and anthrax. From the late 19th century, vaccines were considered a matter of national prestige and compulsory vaccination laws were passed. Let's talk about the principles of vaccination. A vaccine renders the recipient resistant against an infectious agent. During the vaccination process, a particular causative agent or the microorganisms or the antigen is being injected in form of a vaccine or given orally to the body of the host, but in an attenuated form or in a weakened form, so that it can only render the property of antigenicity but not the pathogenicity. As a result, gradually the host produces antibodies against a particular pathogen that is responsible for causing a particular disease within the host body system. After vaccination, gradually the host body started producing antibody and also started fighting against different sorts of specific diseases. Whenever there occurred the re-exposure of the same pathogen in the body of the host, it is inactivated by the antibodies that is produced by the host and the disease state is being prevented. For that particular function of the host body, the responsible cell lines are the memory B cell. Whenever there occur fast exposure or entry of the antigen or the vaccine within the body of the host, B cell can memorize and B cell can recognize them and the particular antibody against them. So whenever there occur re-exposure of the same antigen, our body can take necessary action accordingly. Generally, for the production of a vaccine, pathogen is grown in culture. After that, it is inactivated or non-virulent forms are produced. And only that non-virulent forms or attenuated forms or the weakened form of that particular causative agent can be used for the purpose of vaccination. Let's discuss the mechanism of vaccination. The mechanism of vaccine activation includes few steps. Like after the administration of vaccine, its recognition is being done by the host body. And after proper recognition, the immune competent cells are get activated, followed by onset of a greater immune response. In an ideal scenario, under primary response, whenever a vaccine is first administered, it is phagocytized by an antigen-presenting cell line or APCs. The recent research, they are suggesting that it is particularly important that the vaccines are being taken up by dendritic cell lines. That is because dendritic cells are playing a key role in activating T cells, which become helper T cells later on. From there, the activated T helper cells go on to activate mature B cell lines. The activated mature B cell lines again differentiated into two cell types, like antibody producing plasma B cell and the most importantly memory B cell. During secondary immunity responses, the body mount a quicker, more robust attack on the pathogen. Thus, the pathogen is cleared from the body before it has a chance to cause a further mode of infection. Each vaccine has a recommended administration route and site. Three major routes, such as intradermal administration, oral administration, and intranasal administrations, are there. Besides these three routes, vaccines also can be administered through subcutaneous routes and intramuscular routes. Let's talk about the examples of different routes of vaccine administration. First, talk about the intradermal administration. In case of intradermal administration, vaccines are being injected into the layers of skin. BCG is the example of this intradermal route of vaccination, where the Bacillus calmette-guanine vaccine is being injected into the layers of the skin. Second one is the oral administration, that is being done by mouth. Rotavirus and oral polio vaccines are the examples of oral administration. The third one is intranasal administration. Different types of flu vaccine can be administered through the nasal passage. Let's talk about the intramuscular route of vaccine administration. In this case, vaccines are injected into muscle tissues, DTP, along with hepatitis A and B are being injected following the same route. Lastly, I will discuss about the subcutaneous route. In this route, vaccines are being injected in the area just beneath the skin into the fatty connective tissues. MMR, IPV are the examples of the subcutaneous routed administration vaccines. Now I will discuss about anaphylaxis, a very important phenomenon that is associated with the vaccine administration. It is really a very rare allergic reaction that can take place after administration of vaccination. It can happen one in a million vaccinations. It is really unexpected and can be fatal if not dealt with proper precaution. Vaccine antigens and components that can cause this particular allergic reaction. This reaction can be a local or can be systematic and can include mild to severe anaphylaxis and anaphylactic-like responses. It is mostly mediated by the IgE and it needs medical attention immediately. Now I would like to conclude my lecture. After discussing about the limitations of vaccine production and its application. As of now, conventional vaccines are being employed in the majority of the cases to control any disease or any epidemic. Drawbacks of these established vaccines include the lack of differentiability of infected one from vaccinated one. The basic limitations include efficacy spectrum, time and cost constraint, along with the restriction in production. Application of new generation vaccines like DNA, RNA and subunit vaccines really includes the cost problem. However, the development of vaccines is really a long and expensive process. But vaccine is till date currently the most effective strategy to medically control any sort of viral disease. Although all the type of viral disease cannot be controlled by vaccination because of the antigenic variation and the mutation that is happening in the viral antigen. That's why the vaccine composition needs to be changed almost every year in order to control the strain most likely to be effective. Vaccine efficacy varies according to how closely the immunizing strain resembles the circulating wild strains. It also depends on the viral strain which had appeared in the preceding years, on the number of the doses administered, and on the interval between the vaccination and the natural challenge. The antibody response to vaccine is short-lived, and it is greatest in normal adults, lowest in aged and in immunosuppressed patients. Vaccination reduces clinical infection by 70-80% in children and adults, but only by 30% in elderly patients living in the institutions. Thanks a lot for your patience. Please do subscribe my channel. Stay tuned for the upcoming videos in different fields of biosciences.